Hello everyone. Today I will be discussing about the pressure sore. So what is a pressure sore? It is a localized soft tissue injury resulting from unrelieved pressure. That is prolonged duration of lying or on the lateral decubitus or like in the sitting position. So, and it usually occurs over a bony prominence. This is the recent guidelines or the staging system. It is given by the National Pressure Ulcer Advisory Panel staging system. It is from the USA, and we usually follow this only. And I think I'm sure that it is from where the questions are framed. So first stage is called the intact skin, in which there is a non-blanchable redness of the localized area. So there is no breach of the continuity of the skin. In the second stage, there is partial thickness loss of the dermis. That is, so we can say it in another way, that it is ulcerated. And it is presenting as a shallow open ulcer with a red pink wound bed. In the third stage, there is full thickness tissue loss. Subcutaneous fat may be visible, but the ulcer has not reached the underlying bone or the tendon, and even the muscles are not exposed. So the stage three is where from where the question is asked, and you may be asked which all structures are exposed except for. So in that, these are the direct question. So bone, tendon and muscle, they are not exposed. And the fourth stage is the full thickness tissue loss, in which the bone is exposed, tendon or muscle is exposed. If the external compressive force, so what is the pressure that is required to create a pressure sore? It would be 32 millimeter of mercury. This is where the capillary bed pressure, whichever it is compressed, and capillary perfusion is impaired and ischemia will ensue. Coming to the molecular basis of the progression of the pressure sore, it is the imbalance between the matrix metalloproteases 1 and 9 and the tissue inhibitors of metalloproteases, in which there is elevated level of MMPs and decreased level of tissue inhibitors of metalloproteases in the chronic wound. So this imbalance creates the chronic progression of the wound and non-healing of the wound. Now, we can see in this diagram, the first one shows the pressure areas when the patient is lying in the prone position. So we can see pressure is mostly over the chest and the sternum. Coming to the other highest point is the patella, which shows with the marking with the 50. Both the patellas. This is only this much is significant for us. In the supine position, there are the three major points. First is the occiput. Second is the sacrum, which is marked by the area 60, which shows the highest pressure, and over the heels. This is the diagram which shows the distribution of pressure in a normal sitting position. So first one is when when we are sitting in the feet supported way. That in that position, the ischium receives the maximum pressure. And when we are sitting with the feet unsupported, the pressure just rides over the ischium along with the femur and the supported region. When the patient, when someone is wheelchair bound, then the pressure is extrapolated over the scapula, over the sacrum, over the ischium and posterior aspect of the knee, and over the heels and the foot. And when lying in the lateral decubitus, the pressure areas are the ear. Even in the prone position, you can expect a ear to get pressure injury, over the shoulder, over the iliac crest, and over the thigh in the trochanter region and thigh, and also on the malleolus. These are the critical pressure points. Now, pressure ulcer is not just a simple ulcer. It is like a cone-shaped injury, wherein whatever we see over the at the surface of the wound is very small, and it goes like a tubercular ulcer. In the same manner, it undermines a large area. So when we start to explore the wound over the at the time of debridement, at that time you can see that it has gone into many aspects of the wound, many aspects of the wound area. This diagram shows the inverse relationship between time and pressure for the generation of the ulceration. So if we have very high pressure, like in the 600 millimeter of mercury, and the duration would be very less than 1 hour, it will create a pressure sore. So as we can see, with the low pressure, we require a higher duration of time, and this necessitates about the importance about when we have to relieve the pressure to avoid the pressure injury. Now we will come to the clinical prevention and management. First and the foremost thing is the behavioral modification, because this is the mainstay of the management of the pressure injury. This is because even we do a very good surgery, we can do a many types of flap, but these are limited, as because even after a successful surgery and after some time, say 1 year, 2 year, or it may be very soon, the patient will get another sort of pressure ulcer, which is bound to get even after the very meticulous management and very meticulous care. So we have to keep a constant tap on the behavioral modification. In this, patient should be asked to be mobilized and repositioned very frequently. Sitting should avoid prolonged sitting. Smoking cessation should be encouraged, and perspiration in and around the wound and the skin folds, this should be managed. This is because because the patients are still, they are lying on the bed or wheelchair bound, so they miss this thing and they start excoriating the skin, which leads to another chronic ulcers. There should be effective toileting routine, which prevents the soilage and the maceration. Now coming to the preoperative care, the goal should be to prevent the complications, which are particularly the invasive infection, and preventing the existing sore from getting larger, preventing sores in other location and closure of the wound. The key component of the successful pressure sore coverage is the resolution of infection. So this is the foremost thing, that there should be no infection at the time of any successful management. If there is any underlying infection, then our management will not be sufficient. The preoperative and postoperative relief of pressure should be very well taught and should be very well monitored. This is because once we are done with the surgery, and even in the postoperative period, if we are not very vigilant, then the patient may end up getting another pressure sore, either in the same area or in the other area. And in the chronically non-ambulatory patients, the control of spasm and contracture is a very important thing. This is because the spasms and contracture, they create a high tension, high pressure areas over the skin, and also they cause frequent ulceration in the similar areas. Now coming to the factors which we are required to monitor. First, we have to see the nutrition. We have to manage the infection. The pressure should be relieved. Spasm and contractures are to be dealt with, and the comorbidities of the patients. So in the nutrition, for any wound to heal, we require a total albumin amount to be more than 3 gram per deciliter. And for this thing, the requirement, dietary requirement of the patient should be monitored and made up to 1.5 to 3 gram per kg per day of the protein requirement. And the calorie, non-protein calorie intakes, it should be 25 to 35 calorie per kg of the body weight. Because the malnutrition correlates with development of primary injuries and poor wound healing, we should always consult with a nutritionist to assist and assess for the assessment and dietary modification to meet the caloric goal, because the patient should not be under the negative calorie deficit. Laboratory test results like serum albumin, prealbumin, and micronutrients, that is zinc, calcium, and iron, they should be monitored and adequately dealt with. optimize the healing potential with again healing potential of the wound will be only when the serum albumin will be more than 3 g/dL before operating. Inflammatory markers should be tracked. They are just supportive lab results. We can do it with the C-reactive proteins or the ESR. Regarding the frequent soiling, one may need a colorectal diversion for wound hygiene. This can be adequately, it may be done as a permanent solution or it can be done as a temporary colostomy, which can be reverted back. Also, if the patient is not taking adequate diet, then swallow evaluation can be done. Now the infection, usually the cycle is that there is a compression which leads to impaired lymphatic drainage, which causes the edema, which further leads to ischemia and provides a favorable condition for colonization. So septicemia, pneumonia, and any other UTI, they should are the most common infection and they should be accordingly treated. Bedside swabs of the wound should be avoided because they give the mixed culture growth. So either they should be done in a very sterile setting, like in the operation theater. According to the culture sensitivity reports, the required pathogen should be dealt with. And the bone biopsy, if the bone is visible, then bone biopsy is gold standard for diagnosis of any underlying infection. For the pressure relief, there is no single device that can be proven for superior prevention in the relief of the pressure. One can use a water bed or air bed, or frequently air water bed mix also are there. The best and the clinically dealt which we are seeing which we are do is the pressure relief, that is the every 2 hourly, the position of the patient should be changed. So after every 2 hour, either the position should be changed, or if there is patient is on the air mattress, then it can be deflated and reinflated again, so that the pressure which is created even by the air mattress or water mattress, it gets relieved. Head end of the elevation should be minimized to less than 45 degrees, as it reduces sacral shear forces. Reposition every 2 hours. Encourage mobility. Adjunct pressure offloading devices, that is foam wedges or pillows, should be kept. And in the operating room, adequate padding should be done. Pressure relieving mattresses can be used, and prophylactic foam dressings on high-risk surfaces should be done. Now, for the spasm and contraction management, in the spinal cord injury patient, incidence of the spasm varies with the level of spinal cord. So the more the proximal lesion, higher is the chances. Contracture and spasm, they create a shear forces contributing to pressure injury development. It is usually common in the hip and knee joints. We can give antispasmodic like Drantulin, Baclofen, or Diazepam. Botulinum toxin can also be given, but is a temporary solution as it has to be repeated again after every 3 to 6 months. For the we can do a procedural intervention also, either by giving a peripheral nerve block or epidural stimulator, or baclofen pump can be given, or rhizotomy can also be done. For the continued contracture, either we can do a release of the joint, or if the it is very untreatable situation, then we have to opt for amputation also. For treating the comorbidities, patient should be medically optimized. They should be evaluated for the congestive heart failure, diabetes mellitus, and respiratory failures. Kidney function should be optimized. Urinary or fecal incontinence should be dealt with accordingly, and blood glucose level should be closely monitored, and anemia should be corrected. Now coming to the wound care. It can be done either through the non-operative method or through the surgical way. In the non-operative setting, we can do dressings, negative pressure wound therapy, hyperbaric oxygen therapy, or biologic therapies are there. In the biologic therapy, we usually give the growth factors like platelet-derived growth factor through the PRP, which is the platelet rich plasma, or fibroblast growth factor and granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factors, which tends to improve the wound healing. But the efficacy of these are not very conclusive. Coming to the dressings, dressings are preventive. We can use multilayered silicone dressing with over the sacrum, buttocks and heel in the high-risk environments. Silicone, why we use silicone? Because it is elastic and able to absorb the shear forces and reduces skin deformation. For the dry wounds, we have to create a moist healing environment. Many of these dressings are appropriate. We can use the very common traditional dressing, which is wet to moist saline dressing, but it has to be changed very frequently and depending upon the wound and debridement needs. We can also use sodium hypochlorite solution, which is the darkened solution, 0.25%. It is very effective against the Pseudomonas infection. We can use hydrogels or hydrochloride dressings. These are gel which are water-based and retain moisture for long duration. Even honey has been described in various literature. It provides a good, what I can say, is the moist healing environment. Nowadays, silver-releasing dressing are demonstrated to have a tendency for reducing the risk of infection and promote healing. Clinical analysis are not that much of conclusive. For wounds with large amount of drainage, that is where a lot of soakage is there or slough is there, we use absorbent dressing. It can be derived from the seaweeds, which are the alginate dressings, or hydrochloride gels. Foam dressings are also used, and wicking system can be used. Even negative pressure wound therapy can be applied, as they create a very good environment and continuous suction of the slough is there. So they help in a very good wound healing. Now coming to the surgical plan. Surgery is indicated when there is a necrotizing infection or the wound is very dirty and requires a significant debridement. Biopsy for the malignancy or deep cultures, vasculature exposure, organ is exposed, or there is some foreign body in the wound. But also, if there is a opening of the wound is very small and it has a large underbinding. Now, operative management, it is done under three steps. First, we have to do the debridement. After that, we have to do optimization of the wound. And after the wound is optimized, that is, it is ready for a good cover, then we have to do the reconstruction. Now, debridement and optimization. For the soft tissue, our goal should be to remove all the necrotic tissues. There should not be anything dirty on the wound. Bacterial count should be reduced and biofilm are to be stripped down. We have to convert the chronic wound into an acute wound. For the bone, it is recommended that only the minimal of the bone is to be removed because to avoid the radical osteotomy. Because if we do a radical osteotomy, then it destabilize the bone. Destabilize the joint. For the contracture release and management of the spasticity, these are very important for optimizing the positioning before attempting the final reconstruction, because if we don't do the contracture release and the and manage the spasticity, then even after the very good cover, we will again land up in the same situation. So either we can deal it with the peripheral nerve blocks or the epidural stimulator, or medical rhizotomy can be considered. Now coming to the reconstruction, these are the few I would say the basic principles. First and foremost is for any pressure ulcer, always avoid to do a primary closure. It is very tempting to just close down the wound, and it seems that we can just close the wound and it will heal, but it never heals, because there is always tendency of the underlying infection, and in a pressure wound, there is always deficiency of the soft tissue. So we have to anyhow provide the soft tissue cover. skin graft will likely to be failed in this area because there is lack of adequate tolerance to repeated pressures and shears. So we need a flap cover. There is no reported difference in success using myocutaneous or fasciocutaneous flap. So we can use any of the flap according to the position and the availability. Now coming to the management of the pressure sore injury by the location over the ischium. Since these defects are common in patients who are seated for prolonged duration, the recurrence rate is high. So flap reconstruction are foremost thing. For doing a flap design, the ambulatory status, the possibility of future flap should be taken into the account and avoid placing incisions over weight-bearing prominences. We can consider a flap that can be advanced subsequently, because we may require any other flap that should be always kept in the mind. For the sacrum, these defects are common in the supine or the bedridden patient. This is one of the very common question that in the supine position, which is the most common area for getting the pressure sore. So the answer is the sacrum. Fasciocutaneous or musculocutaneous flap can be done. Most common musculocutaneous flap in this region is gluteus maximus muscle cover. It can be superiorly or inferiorly based. Over the trochanter, this is the most common pressure sore occurring when the patient is positioned laterally. The flap reconstruction is mostly from the tensor fascia lata, but a pedicle LT flap can also be an option. Now, even after the wound management, these are the risk factors for post-operative complications. First of the is the in a recurrence or reoperation requiring complication is the young age of the patient. If the albumin is low, location of the wound, that is the initial wound, they tend to recur. Flap choice, a VY thigh flap, because there is a pressure point in it. In the setting of the infection is also a risk factor. So if the patient has a diabetes or the anesthesiologist grade 3, or even if the operative duration is long, then also the patient is at a risk of postoperative complication. Here are the few questions. So first question is the 56-year-old woman with a history of hypertension and depression who sustained a pressure injury after prolonged immobilization following motor vehicle accident. She has a healing right ischial pressure sore stage 3 and she has lost weight also. Her recent counts are given in this question. She's performing wet to dry packing with the normal saline and she feels that her wound is not progressing, likely to consider for surgical closure. So what should be our next step? We can schedule a surgery, obtain an MRI to ensure no bone involvement, consult the nutritionist to optimize the wound before the surgery, continue local wound care or schedule the surgery for total ischectomy. So in this, when we look at the parameters, the counts are low. Counts are normal. Hemoglobin is also good, but the albumin is 2.1, which is not according to our the wound healing definition. So the answer should be the patient should consult with the nutritionist for optimization prior to elective surgery. Okay, so that is the answer. Coming to the second question, there is a 37-year-old male with history of traumatic spinal cord injury at T6 levels undergoes debridement for the ischial pressure injury. Within 1 hour of the patient's arrival there, he complains of nausea, neck pain, temperature is slightly raised, blood pressure is 190-100, that is very hypertensive and heart rate is low. So this picture, it corresponds to the autonomic dysreflexia. Now, what should be considered first in the working of this patient? So we should, since it is a dysreflexia situation, we should always look for the urine output and put a Foley's catheter. That is because the bladder bowel pressures, they are, the patient don't have any sensation regarding that. So if the bladder outlet is blocked or if we have not put a Foley's catheter, then we have to relieve it. Otherwise, they tend to get clinically unstable. Coming to the third question, a 54-year-old woman with paraplegia since the age of 24 comes at our clinic with a stage 4 pressure injury, in which we see on inspecting the wound, it is denuded bone based on the wound and pink granulating tissue on the periphery. She has been diligent with the pressure offloading and wound care with moisture dressing, but does not seem to be improving. Which of the following is the most appropriate next step? So we can do an MRI schedule for the elective flap, order CT of the pelvis, schedule debridement and bone biopsy, long-term palliative care. So answer is the schedule for the debridement and bone biopsy. This is because patient with the chronic non-healing wound, even after the adequate wound care, they should be first investigated for the underlying condition. And any bone which is exposed, it should be first biopsied, and according to that the wound should be optimized, and then we should proceed for the surgery. The other question is, a 38-year-old woman who works in accounting and spends most of her time in a wheelchair presents to you clinic with proconcentric pressure related sore. After the appropriate workup, we decide to cover for the wound cover with a posterior thigh musculocutaneous flap. The chief disadvantage of the flap is unreliable blood supply, limited amount of skin, fat, muscle, limited upward mobility of the flap, inability to readvance, or high rate of donor morbidity. So the answer is the limited upward mobility of the flap. This is because the wound is on the lateral side, although the blood supply is really good. Good skin cover is also there, but the upward mobility is only 10 to 12 centimeter of the movement. This is because when we'll rotate the musculocutaneous flap, most of the length is lost in the rotation, and we don't get a adequate movement and tissue at our defect. Now, this is the last question. We receive a consult for 19-year-old boy who underwent a 13-hour surgery, after which he has redness of skin and breakdown over the scapula and sacrum. There are well-demarcated areas of redness and blanching of the skin involving the epidermis. Only overlying the tip of the scapula and sacrum. There is no drainage or exposed structure. And the most appropriate next step is local wound care with placement of soft foam dressing and redress pressure offloading. Second is to excision of the blanching. Third is the excision of blanching area with grafting, excision with the advanced flap, no intervention, encourage discharge from the hospital as soon as possible. So the correct answer is the local wound care. This is because it is a sign of an early stage pressure injury. So these are the iatrogenic pressure related injuries, and we have to manage it on the, this is a iatrogenic pressure injury. We should be very carefully managing the wound and avoid this and this should be avoided in the upcoming surgeries. I think this is enough for the pressure sore injury. All the slides and all the material, you can get it from me also. And I think it covers most of the topics and most of the questions which may come in your NEET SS exams. This can be also used as a basic answer for your MS exam also. Thank you.